What's up, everybody?
Welcome back to Mile Higher Podcast, episode 138. And today we are here to do what we used to call a ponder sesh, but we felt like we got to switch up the name a little bit because now we have the sesh podcast. So all sesh things need to be on the sesh podcast. So instead, we are doing a ponder potluck.
Potluck, if you know what I mean.
Well, we are each going to be bringing things to the table. So that's why I see it as a potluck. We each have a few short topics that we couldn't make an entire episode out of. So we put them all into these ponder potluck episodes so you can get a little taste of everything. And we have topics from ancient history to like aliens, ghosts. I don't know what you guys got, but I have all types of stuff.
I have some natural phenomena type stuff.
Nice.
Yeah, it's going to be a whole bunch of stuff.
Do you have any paranormal?
It's a surprise. Paranormal, no. Paranormal in a sense, they're talking about aliens, but...
That's paranormal.
Yeah.
So I'd be surprised if Josh didn't bring any paranormal.
I was going to say, I definitely got to bring some of that with me. So, but before we get into some pondering, I want to thank our sponsors for today. We got Quip, Zebit, HelloFresh, Native, and Honey. Make sure you guys check those out. As well as another way to support the show that is actually free is if a lot of you I know love watching the show on YouTube. Mm-hmm. And that's awesome and everything. But if you haven't gone over to Apple Podcasts yet and subscribed or gone to Spotify and hit follow, we'd really appreciate it if you went and did that if you haven't already, just because YouTube isn't really counted in the whole podcast performance analytics yet. So it does really help out our show if you do subscribe to us over there on Spotify and Apple Podcasts.
Yeah, and a big thank you to everyone who's done that already. It does help a lot, and we have seen the numbers go up, so thank you.
Absolutely. But we've got a couple news topics for you this week, some kind of out there things that probably you haven't even heard of because you know, this past week was pretty pretty busy with the election and everything. Yeah. So that's been the
pretty busy
24/7 news cycle has been mm-hmm. all about the big election. Mm-hmm. So here's a couple things that you may not have heard about that we found out about this week. So the first thing is about fast radio bursts. And this is something like we keep revisiting because it keeps coming up in the news. And if you're not familiar with a fast radio burst, essentially it's an energy pulse coming from space. And, you know, we've heard about this a lot of times where they're like, oh, we're getting these, you know, fast radio bursts from, you know, this star system and some other, you know, mm-hmm. galaxy is set, you know, sending these our way. And there's this whole debate about what they are. It is still kind of this unexplained phenomena at this point, these FRBs, as they're called. And we don't really know why we're seeing these and why we're detecting them and what's causing them.
Because they could be caused by something natural. Possibly.
Well, that's the way a lot of astronomers lean, is that it is a natural occurrence that's happening as a result of stars that are either exploding or doing other things where they're emitting this energy mm-hmm. off of it that pulses and travels through space over, you know, millions and millions of light years away, where eventually we pick up on it and we're able to detect it with our telescopes and antennas and things like that. So the reason why this news and why we're even talking about this today is because scientists actually finally traced an FRB from within our own galaxy. So the Milky Way, for the first time, we were able to trace it to within our own galaxy.
Were they able to narrow it down exactly where?
They narrowed it down to what they believe is a magnetar, which is essentially an incredibly dense neutron star. So they're pretty sure that it's these stars that are sending these impulses into space. Mm-hmm. But they are able to trace it back to an original location, I guess. I don't know. I'm sure there's a lot of fancy math that goes into that, but mm-hmm. they were able to trace it back to this magnetar.
You said that I'm so unsure of yourself.
I guess they were able to trace it back to this magnetar that is in the Milky Way. So this neutron star. But again, we don't know if for sure that these fast radio bursts are in fact coming from stars. So it's kind of like this, you know, that's our best guess based on science and evidence.
Or it could be aliens.
A lot of people like to believe that it's possibly extraterrestrials that are communicating with us, and we're just not able to decipher the signals, or we're not picking up the right information.
Or maybe they're not trying to communicate with us. They're trying to communicate with someone else, and we're just picking up their signal.
You know, yeah, it's true. Just, we could be in the middle and it could be going right past us, right, and somebody else is picking it up.
Well, think about if there really are several different alien species out there. They probably communicate with each other through,
you know, I was gonna say, maybe. Do you think that, you know, if there is other life out there in the universe and in other galaxies, do you think there is a way to communicate from galaxy to galaxy?
I mean, I wouldn't fucking know, but I bet there probably is. I mean, if they're, you know, skilled enough or advanced enough, I should say, to be able to travel, I assume you'd be able to send messages too.
Yeah.
Especially because that one mess, the Carl Sagan message, went quite far. So I'm sure on a, with better technology, could probably go even farther. I bet that's what it is. We're picking up like a message that's not for us.
Yeah.
That's my guess.
A lot of people do believe that's what's happening. It's not just a natural phenomena that's happening. And I think in some cases it could be stars that are doing this and they're, you know, emitting it. It makes sense, right? For them to emit.
Totally could be.
These impulses of energy. But
it's more fun to think it's aliens though.
It is. It is more fun. So while we're on the topic of aliens, I wanted to just bring up this tweet from Elon Musk from a couple of weeks ago, because I just thought it was interesting to hear his thoughts about, you know, alien life. I think a lot of people wonder, is Elon Musk an alien believer? Does he believe in UFOs? I thought you were going to
say, is he an alien? Well, I kind of wonder that.
It's possible. It's possible. So he tweeted, doesn't seem to be any life in this solar system. Maybe under the ice of Europa or an extremophile bacteria below the surface of Mars. And this was in response to like a fan that tweeted him a question about, do you think there's aliens or alien life in our solar system? And this was his response, which to, you know, if there was prevalent alien life in our solar system, we probably would have found some sign of it already. Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, we have, you know, imaged our entire solar system. We've sent rovers now to Mars, and we've sent probes to even farther out in the solar system. So we've gotten, I mean, if you look at the pictures that NASA has of all the planets, it's like, okay, if there was some advanced form of life on any of these planets, then we probably would have found it by now, right? We would have seen a sign, or they would have communicated with us, unless they're inside of, you know, a core of a planet, which is fun to think about. Or I
mean, it's possible, right?
My view is, it got decimated and we are the only planet with advanced life on it left in our solar system. I think if you go back millions and millions, maybe billions of years, multiple planets in this solar system were covered with life.
That's what I personally believe too.
Because when you look at where the planets are and you look at this perfect solar system we seemingly have and this home star, that's the perfect, you know, length away or, you know, distance away from us, perfect conditions. And I mean, you look at Mars, it's not that much farther out from the sun. So it'd still be capable, if it had an atmosphere, it'd still be capable of having life on it.
I think a lot of people would agree with that about Mars. You know, when you see some of the evidence for that too,
it's
really quite possible.
I mean, they're continuing to find more and more evidence of life on Mars and evidence of life that existed before on Mars that doesn't anymore for some reason. I think we are going to find at least extremophile, you know, organisms on Mars. There's going to be some form of life. We just got to go deep enough into it. Cause I think what happened is once the entire, you know, atmosphere disappeared, everything burrowed, everything went down.
So you disagree with Elon then?
Yes. I think he's leaving the door open to possibility of like bacteria or tiny organisms.
Like he said, of Mars and Europa.
But I leave the door open to perhaps maybe if there was, you know, humans or humanoid type beings on Mars, that perhaps they went underground and there could be some sort of colony of humans or some form of beings that lives within Mars. And we just haven't found them yet because they're below the surface because there's no atmosphere. They can't go out on the surface.
Maybe we should just do an episode on Mars and look into all those theories.
Well, I mean, there's only so much about the theories. I just gave you the theories.
Well, I feel like there's probably more we could dig up. and look at.
There could be. We could take a look. But yeah.
Let us know if you want to see that.
Let us know what you think about that one. But yeah, that's the first little news topic for you. The second one, though, is about dogs. We all love our dogs.
This is awesome.
And this was really cool. There was new research that was published in the journal Science. And basically, an international team of scientists were able to trace dog domestication back 11,000 years to the end of the Ice Age. So that's how long dogs have been domesticated for, 11,000 years at least.
Man's best friend. It's like it's in their DNA to want to be around humans.
Yeah.
Want to have a relationship with humans.
Yeah. Well, what they did is they analyzed the whole genomes of 27 ancient dog breeds. Basically, the scientists found that dog genetic patterns directly mirror human ones because the people 11,000 years ago took their dogs with them when they migrated. So a lot of the, when you look at the DNA genome profiles, I'm no geneticist here. A little bit out of my realm of expertise here. I know a lot, but geneticist, I don't even know if I'm saying that right, but
Welcome to the show.
But anyway, bottom line is the DNA, when you look at the patterns, they're similar with how human DNA evolved over 11,000 years. There's similar, you know, things that mirror each other so that they're like, oh, okay, the dog has been alongside the human for a very long time. If we're able to look back at the whole DNA makeup of dogs and humans and see a clear change depending on where they moved, because humans migrated all over, Pangea and all of that, and how, you know, it was one big continent potentially at one time, and over time it spread out and humans migrated from, you know, the other side of the world to where we are now. And, you know, when you look at the different breeds that come from these areas, there's a lot of similarities in their DNA to the actual humans that moved into these areas as well.
That's really interesting. Wow.
So scientists believe that dogs are the earliest animal that was ever domesticated, period. Wow. Even the horse.
Really? Before the horse?
Before the horse, before any other type of creature.
I mean, it really does make sense. And like I said, it's like they're built to be with humans and be a pet. They're like, that's their role in life.
And what's crazy is that all of these breeds can be traced directly back to the wolf. That even our little fluffy havanese, if you go far back enough, they originate with the wolf.
They're ferocious beasts.
Yes, they are. I love that. That's really interesting.
But what's the last point I had about this, though, is that they don't know how or what caused, like, how did you domesticate the wolf? How was that done? How do you go from wolf to havanese?
That is interesting.
But
like, at one point, did someone have a wolf as a pet?
Yes. No, that's what they're saying, is that 100% they were wolves were their pets.
I believe it, especially if you had raised it from, you know, a pup. It would become, I'm sure you could teach it. Just like people have, some people have like tigers and stuff as pets.
Right.
Like a Tiger King.
Right.
I feel like that's, you know, not that I encourage that at all, but you know, I can see how you would, you know, with patience and time, you could train anything to really be a pet. And then over time.
And breeding the same, you know, the same people's wolves over and over and over again, over thousands and thousands
of
years.
It's like in their DNA.
And, you know, obviously there's environmental factors, I think, come into it too. Because some of these breeds like only come from certain areas of the world, like the Rhodesian Ridgeback, I think is how.
Rhodesian Ridgeback.
It's the Ridgeback. I believe that's how it's pronounced.
Our little Javis come from Cuba.
From South Africa. And yeah, different parts of the world affected the actual makeup of that dog, which is interesting.
That is interesting.
So like, depending on where they took the wolves to, over time, the wolves adapted to those conditions. And through evolution, we got all these different dog breeds. Wow. But it's a mystery on how we got from point A to point B. We don't know how we got all of these breeds from the wolf. We just know that over time.
Yeah, I've always wondered that too.
But at what point was it domesticated? We have no idea.
Wow.
So quite the mystery there. But the last bit of news we wanted to mention happened this week during the election. And obviously everybody was focused on the presidential election, but there was a lot of things on the ballot for a lot of different states. And one of those things was the legalization of cannabis or Mary Jane. and five
that's
new
what was
states.
On the ballot, yeah. Legalization of Mary Jane.
Mary Jane, yes. But great news, five states
yep.
passed legalization for recreational yeah. and medical. Out of the five states that passed some form of marijuana legalization was New Jersey, Arizona, Montana. They passed both recreational and medical. Mm-hmm. But then South Dakota and Mississippi passed medical marijuana measures.
That's amazing.
It really is.
Welcome to the club, guys. We love to see it. And I know so many people, so many of our fans I know are really happy about this. If you live in these areas, I mean, it really sucks not to have access to that, especially if you have some type of condition and you could benefit from it medically. This is huge for so many people, life changing. So I'm so excited to see it. Hopefully the rest of the country joins in.
And stops moving to Colorado.
Just yeah. yeah, please stop. Please stop.
Another chip on weed.
Well, it'll be interesting to see, you know, the next 4 years where legalization goes and mm-hmm. sees, you know, maybe we'll see a complete federal,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
you know, lift of the marijuana ban, you know, yeah. and we'll see that removed off of the schedule. Drug lists, you know, that'd I really hope, you know, that's the snowball effect starting to take place and more states, you know, jump on board or they just, you know, legal mm-hmm. nationwide. Like mm-hmm. what's the point to keep it out at this point, you know?
Yeah, I agree. And then Oregon too.
Yeah.
That Oregon. Was big.
Oregon was huge. So they had this measure called Measure 110 and it was the Drug Decriminalization and Addiction Treatment Initiative, which passed and actually pretty convincingly too, 60-40. The Measure 110 reclassified the low-level possession of a bunch of illegal substances, including psychedelics. And before, if you were to be caught with these substances, it'd be at least a misdemeanor, if not a felony. And it was basically changed from that to a non-criminal violation, which would just be punishable by either a $100 fine or a health assessment.
Wow. They're headed towards like Amsterdam mm-hmm. status.
Yeah.
Pretty cool.
And come February 1st, the state will halt jailing people for petty possession, period.
Oh,
so, you know,
we'd love to see
if you
it.
Get caught with a small amount of drugs, obviously, if you're a drug mule or you're
yeah.
you're moving big mm-hmm. quantities, that's still going to be a charge because you mm-hmm. can't traffic these things. That's
right. Yeah.
You know, that's still going to be a felony. But as far as low level possession, which was like so many cops episodes, so much of Live PD mm-hmm. was low level, like, oh, I got a little bit of weed. I got a little
it
bit of this.
It was really irritating to watch that show.
And people were getting locked up, going to jail, ruining, yeah. you know, losing their jobs, having to pay for, you know, mm-hmm. bonding out and lawyers and everything. So
yeah, not to mention the amount of people that are in jail right now.
Yeah, seriously. You know? Seriously.
It's just absurd. So this is a step in the right direction for sure.
Well, and it's great that, you know, Oregon's doing it. I hope Colorado follows uh-huh. suit.
We probably will.
California. I hope at least, you know, it's West Coast and spreads east.
Yeah.
Because again, this is directly going to affect the war on drugs. It's going to effectively eliminate it. I mean, if people aren't getting locked up and going to jail for, you know, petty possession of substances, then they might actually be able to solve some crime. You know, yeah. like there might be, you know, resources be better things. Allocated for other things. Yep. And mm-hmm. and again, it's obviously not good if you're addicted to any of these hard mm-hmm. substances.
Right.
We know that that causes a lot of issues. There's a lot of, you know, negative things that can come out of that. But I think
criminalizing it is not necessarily the solution for that.
Right. Right. And why not try a different solution? Because the current one's not working. Mm-hmm. People are going to prison. And if you watch any of the prison shows, I love 60 Days In. There's so
right
much
in.
Drugs yeah. in there. Everybody's doing drugs. Mm-hmm. No, you can't stay clean in there.
No.
It's like, what's the point? So yeah. why are you locking
it's not a solution. It really isn't.
It's not. So,
yeah.
Hopefully, yeah. Hopefully this will show the rest of the country that this can be done. And mm-hmm. this is Oregon wide too. So congrats to all the
yeah.
Oregonians.
Oregonians, congrats to you.
Congrats to you. But before we get into our Ponder Potluck, we'd like to thank our first sponsors for today. Do you like to online shop? If you do, then you need to make sure that you have the browser extension Honey installed at all times, because Honey is going to be your best friend whenever you're online shopping. I've been using Honey for a very long time, probably 5+ years. It might even be longer than that. So far before they sponsored us, but Honey is absolutely one of the most revolutionary add-ons that you can have for your browser because it saves you money pretty much everywhere. If you're not familiar with Honey, basically it's a free browser extension that scours the internet for promo codes and automatically applies the best one available at checkout. Now you might be thinking, Josh, what's a browser extension? I have no idea what that is. Well, Don't you worry. It is extremely easy to get the Honey browser extension installed on any computer. Go to joinhoney.com/milehigher and then literally two clicks to get it installed. That's all it takes for Honey to be installed on your browser. And once Honey's been added, you can now shop at over 30,000 supported sites, and Honey will pop up automatically at checkout to see if there's any coupons that it can apply for you. And if Honey finds some coupon codes for you, all you have to do is hit apply coupons and it automatically goes through and adds it directly to your cart, and bada bing, bada boom. You're saving money with the free Honey browser extension. Recently, I purchased some new computer hardware, and boom, at checkout, Honey had a coupon code for me that actually saved me about $30. Just like that. I mean, it was super simple, super easy, and who doesn't like to save money? So it's simple. If you have a computer, Honey should be on it. It's free and it works with whatever browser you use. You can get Honey for free today at joinhoney.com/milehigher. That's joinhoney.com/milehigher.
Lately, it is all about the meal kits, as I'm sure a lot of you know, and our favorite meal kit is HelloFresh. We love it because we're so busy with all the content that we make and all the shows that we have that sometimes we just don't have time to make dinner, and it's so nice to have a HelloFresh box waiting for you, or your meal's just ready to go in the fridge. You take out the meal, you take out the recipe card, everything is right there. It's so, so convenient. And what I love about it is it has just what you need, so there's no food waste, because that's a big thing for us as well. Oftentimes we'll buy too much of something and then we don't use it and it just goes to waste. And now they offer convenient no contact delivery, which is perfect these days. And the recipes are easy to follow with simple steps and pictures to guide you along the way. 90% of their ingredients are sourced directly from growers to ensure peak flavors and ripeness. And they have over 20 crafted delicious options every week that you can choose from to help you break out of that recipe rut, try new things, and learn how to make some new things. And HelloFresh is the first global carbon neutral meal kit company. And the packaging that HelloFresh uses to ship your food is almost entirely made from recyclable or already recycled content. And it's flexible for your lifestyle. You can easily change your delivery days or your meal plan preferences, or skip a week whenever you need to. So go to HelloFresh.com/milehigher90 and use code milehigher90 to get $90 off, including free shipping. That's HelloFresh.com/MileHigher90 with code MileHigher90 for $90 off, including free shipping.
For so long, my dental hygiene routine was so complicated. It felt like so many times I'd forget to floss, or I'd forget to buy replacement heads for my toothbrush, or even get new toothpaste for that matter. But once I found Quip, all of that hassle with my dental routine went out the window, because Quip makes it extremely easy to keep your mouth exceptionally clean. I'm sure you've heard us talk about the Quip electric toothbrush before. Literally, this is the best toothbrush I have ever used, because they send you brush heads on a dentist recommended schedule that you just pop on. It comes with a case. It's super, super convenient. It's got the pulses to remind you to switch sides of your mouth, so you always get that perfect clean. Hopefully you have the toothbrush by now. If you don't, definitely pick that up. But you'll also want to check out their new sleek and reusable floss pick. This thing is super nice, guys. The durable handle makes it easy to guide, restrings with a click, no more, you know, twirling out of it, you overusing the floss. None of that anymore. It comes with a compact mirror dispensing case for on-the-go use as well. Plus, a single refill pod replaces over 180 single-use plastic flossers if you've used those before. So it's better for your teeth and the environment. Quip has got your toothbrushing and flossing needs for all ages as well. Plus, their anti-cavity toothpaste is top of the line. It tastes amazing. They've got mint, watermelon, and I gotta say, it's definitely the best toothpaste I've ever used. And not only that, on top of all of those things, you can now get amazing rewards for just brushing your teeth every day, because the new Quip Smart Electric Toothbrush connects to the free Quip app, and you'll earn amazing rewards like free products and discounts every time you brush. It literally syncs with your phone. This is high-tech technology for a very, very affordable price. Plus, Quip delivers brush head, floss, and toothpaste refills every 3 months from $5, and shipping is free, so you can save the money and skip the store. And if you go to getquip.com/milehigher right now, you'll get your first refill free. That's your first refill free at getquip.com/milehigher. getquip.com/milehigher. Quip. Better oral health made simple.
Okay, you guys ready to ponder?
I'm ready.
Are you?
To ponder.
I have some good things to ponder here.
What'd you bring to our potluck today?
Well, the first thing that I want to talk about is something I've been meaning to talk about since like the first ponder sesh we ever did. And I just forget every single time. So this time, ooh, it's my first one. This is the Solway Spaceman. If you could Google that, Janelle, pull it up on the screen. Got to see this.
Saw, like S-A-W?
S-O-L-W-A-Y.
Solway.
Solway Spaceman. Okay, so the picture that we are looking at was taken on a summer's day in 1964. If you are listening, it's a photo of a little girl. But as you can see, there's what looks to be a spaceman in the back. So Jim Templeton took his daughter Elizabeth and his wife Anne on a walk to their usual spots. And they were just going to go out and take some pictures because she had just gotten this new dress. And he was into photography.
This is the 1960s, you said?
Yeah.
Okay.
So an older camera when photos were developed and everything.
I was going to say that haircut makes sense. All right.
Yeah, definitely. The haircut definitely makes sense now. So when he first took the picture, he didn't see anything like this. He didn't see this spaceman in the background. He had no idea. And obviously, you don't get to see your pictures right away. He had to bring them in to be developed. But when he developed them, he was really freaked out to see this spaceman figure standing behind his daughter. And this photo has been highly debated over the last, 60 years. People trying to figure out what this was, because he claims that no one else was around. He would have remembered if there was a spaceman, right?
Okay.
And so he had taken several photos, and this is the only one where this spaceman shows up. And the only person around was Anne, his wife.
Okay. So, and they're referencing what looks to be like a form, like the upper body of a human. And I guess I can see why they call it spaceman, because it kind of looks like a helmet, or honestly, it could even be like somebody in a hazmat suit.
Yeah.
You know, like a full body PPE or something like that, because it's just like this all white thing.
So there's been all types of theories, obviously, because people are like, maybe it's a time traveler, maybe it's an alien, maybe it's a ghost. What could it be? And this photo has been scrutinized. I mean, it's confirmed that this is in no way photoshopped or altered by him. This is the original photo. He even sent it into Kodak because they made the camera that he was using, and they tested it, and they made sure that he did not alter the photo. This is a real photograph. And like I said, highly debated.
Could that be then? Is there any sort of camera setting that could cause something like that?
No. Kodak has no explanation for it, and they even offered a reward for anyone that could explain it, and no one ever came forward being able to explain that photo, which is really interesting. So he'd started getting letters all over the world when they first went to the public with this, because all those, little tabloid type magazine, Daily Mail, Express, all were covering this all the time back then. And so he got letters from people saying it was a spirit, or maybe that his daughter had psychic powers that he was not aware of.
Hmm.
And this was like her spirit guide or something like that. Even two men in black came forward and said that they actually came to his house once and asked where the picture was taken, and referred to each other as number 9 and 11. But the guy that took it, Jim, doesn't think it was a legit thing. He thinks they were kind of trolling him.
Okay.
So there's all types of theories. One of the theories is, this is wild, but a possible link to a launch that was going on in Woomera, South Australia. I'm probably saying that so wrong. Sorry. But just days after Jim had taken this photo of his daughter, there was this missile test that was going on in Australia. And it ended up being aborted by technicians because they reported seeing two men just all of a sudden show up in the firing range that looked like this, that were in weird spacesuits. And when they saw the photo, they said they were stunned because it looked just like the people they saw at the missile launch that they canceled over.
But, okay.
Which doesn't make any sense. Yeah. There's no other connection. That's just a theory that people have, is like, it's some type of time traveler. And that shows that the time traveler also showed up at the missile launch.
Okay.
So that's one theory.
Okay.
There's nothing else to it, though. There's nothing else that connects the two incidents. The most reasonable and accepted theory is that it's just his wife, Annie, and that, or Anne, I'm not sure. But they say that the person is facing away from the camera, and that the visor could be her hair, and it's just reflecting, and that her skin looks white because of overexposure. And that the camera's viewfinder lens only lets you see 20% of the shot, so he could have easily just not seen her in the frame at the time he was taking it, because it's in the outer 20%.
I don't know, though. That doesn't really make a lot of sense to me.
Right?
That doesn't look like... I mean the angle, mm-hmm. the angle at which the little person is coming out of her head is like to the side, like kind of, yeah. Like if it were her, why would she be standing like that? Like that, I guess it kind of makes sense, but at the same time, I'm like, nah.
I know that it's really hard for me to believe that is the mom and that he wouldn't have known. I like to think it's something different, but I don't really understand cameras that much. And I know sometimes pictures really can, or, you know, people can end up super distorted, especially with older cameras, but I don't know. I still, especially that it looks like a spacesuit, it just makes me think it's a time traveler or something like
Yeah. I mean, the fact that the arms are so defined, I mean, it clearly looks like it has at least a left arm. You know, you can see the arm there.
No, it looks like a clear, like a person. But yeah, they said
the only thing I can think of is maybe a cloud, a low hanging cloud or something. But again, the visor. Yeah, the rest of the sky is.
And there are clouds clear. In the picture, actually. If you look closely, there's other clouds you can see, and they look completely different. That one's overexposed, but the last one, yeah, you can see there's clouds. I mean, that's clearly not a cloud.
Maybe it's like some ectoplasm or something. Maybe ectoplasm. She is clairvoyant. I mean, I understand the theory that, you know, perhaps this child is psychic or has clairvoyant abilities. Or
is special.
You know, ectoplasm is an idea that spirits can manifest in this almost like goo. Like it looks like mm-hmm. goo, but it's not. It's more like clouds. It's kind of like clouds that they take form. Spirits can
smoke almost.
It's almost like smoke. But at the same time, it's like, was it just coming out of her scalp? Like,
I don't know.
Her mouth is closed.
It looks far behind her. I know, it's creepy, huh? It's
a very interesting photo. I bet you most likely there's some sort of explanation for that.
Yeah, it's that it's the wife, Anne.
Or the camera is what I'm saying. I think there could be a camera thing. No,
trust me. Every camera person in the world has looked at this shit. No one can definitively say what it is. Trust me. This is a big topic. It's been debated so long. No one's come up with shit. It's really total. The wife is the best guess. Is that's his wife?
Could they have set this up? Like put her in.
Some people believe that. Yeah, they could have hoaxed it. Like, would he really have gone to all that extent? And Kodak literally said, if you can prove that he hoaxed this, come forward. They had a reward. No one ever did.
Nobody ever tried to recreate it.
No.
And see if they could.
Nope. No one ever could recreate it. Yeah, it's really a true unsolved mystery. All right, Janelle, what do you got?
Okay. All right, so mine have to do with natural phenomena, and one of them takes place in the Namibian desert or the Namib desert, and they're called Namibian fairy circles. Oh. So in southern Africa, there's the Namib desert. It's huge, and there's all these tiny little splotches, basically, of a bunch of... Well, they call them fairy circles, but we don't really know what they are. They range from 10 to 65 feet in diameter, and they stretch upon like hundreds and hundreds of miles. And so a lot of scientists have looked into this land here. And one thing is that the desert is extremely dry. Obviously, it's in Africa, and so water is very limited. And a lot of people believe that as the vegetation expands and gathers, it kind of patches together because there's plants fighting for different water all the time. You know, they're always like trying to grab whatever small bit of moisture is in the ground. And so they think that they kind of form into these clusters of plants and then everything else around them dies. But if you look at the pictures, I do not see, like, look at these. And I'll put them up on the screen. They're like almost perfect circles and they're quite big. And in the middle of them is just like nothingness, and then around them is like little shrubs. And so people say that it's because the water is trying to, you know, is being pulled, I guess, by the plants. But then another theory is that it could be termites creating this. I guess it's like a known thing that under each one of these patches there's a bunch of termites under there, and so they think that maybe there's kind of, they like, you know, form little colonies, and then they form together, and then if another colony tries to come near them, they attack them. So that leaves like the dead patch, which I'm like, I don't know. I tried to read best and like, you know, put my scientist hat on here, but still doesn't make a lot of sense to me. Like,
well, yeah. The termite theory actually kind of makes a lot of sense, because it would, you know, termites are a lot like ants. Mm-hmm. And what do ants do? They build ant hills. Mm-hmm. So termites are a lot larger. Mm-hmm. So it's possible that they could do, you know, do something like that. Like if you've ever seen like an ant farm and how like artistic ants can be,
yeah,
they can do really cool stuff. So why couldn't a termite make like almost perfect circles in the ground?
But then why are they so vegetation? Separate?
Yeah, I don't understand why they...
Well, why are ant hills all separate?
What would be the point of making them all circles? They just want to make them
circles?
Yeah,
that's just what they do. Why does an ant build a little pyramid for himself?
Because they live in it. What is this? Well, termites just decorating and wants to make it a circle? Like, don't they just eat what's in front of them?
That's why I'm kind of confused. Like, I guess because, well, they say that the reason why they're circles is because the termites hang out in the circles, and then the second another colony touches them, then they freak out and attack them. So that's why they're like separated
all in these with.
But I'm like, are termites that fucking smart?
I mean, maybe. I mean, you do make a good point, Josh, that if, I mean, yeah, bugs can be that smart. Insects can be that smart. Maybe. I guess. I mean, I don't know shit about termites.
I mean, if you ever seen a termite colony, like, yeah.
Oh, really?
I mean, termites can literally eat your whole house if they want to.
Look up termite colony on YouTube.
Yeah, look up. Yeah. Oh. Termites are serious, man. I mean, it makes sense to me that they would do. Yeah, I know. I was going to say, you love looking at bee colonies and stuff, but termites are...
ant colonies. It's not a bee. I want like an up-close National Geographic type thing.
What the fuck?
Termite colonies.
Oh, it's so good.
Termites of Africa or something.
An in-depth look at an ant colony is some fascinating shit. How it all works. It's really complex.
So if they're below the ground, maybe that's just like how they leave their...
Janelle's going to die.
That is disgusting.
Yeah. Oh, it looks like maggots. Janelle's going to die.
I'm not looking. I literally...
No, they're just big.
No,
big
look, ants. That's their baby sack, I think.
Baby sack?
Yeah.
Their larva? Probably.
Editing their this larva. Later is really going
to be... Oh, I'm so happy for you, Janelle. This is called exposure therapy.
Yeah, okay.
Why
they look stupid to me.
Okay. No, that's really what making the circle. Like, are they a lot of ancestors of this land, the Maruku, I believe, is what the group of ancestors here are called. A lot of them believe that they're, you know, footprints of the god. And there's also a story that a mythical dragon lives in a deep crack under the earth, and that the dragon's poisonous breath kills vegetation to create circles.
That would be lit.
Okay.
Maybe. I would be so happy if
that
was
true. Can't rule it out.
You can't rule out. But I just thought it was like fascinating to look at. It's so weird that, but the thing is to me is like, why isn't this existing in other parts of the earth? Why is it just in the Namibian desert?
I mean, it's just the Namibian desert. Termites, apparently. They've got a special knack for this. I don't know. That's pretty weird.
Yeah, I don't know.
Well, could it be something else?
I mean, I'm sure like people think that it's could be aliens maybe sending a message or something.
What's the message?
Right, exactly. What is the message? I don't know.
And don't this know. Has been happening as far back as we know.
As far back as we know.
That's pretty interesting. I bet the termite theory is most likely what it is.
Yeah. I agree.
Because they're saying that the termites are killing the grass in the circles and they just happen to do it in that shape. But
like, why that specific shape? Don't you think they would be like weird little like, you know, these are like almost perfect circles. That's what's weirding me out. Wouldn't you think they'd just be like splotches?
Well, that's kind of the, like we just looked too with the termite colonies. I mean, it's kind of just like clumps of, you know, it's not perfect circles like this. So there's actually a lot of scientists that do not believe that it's termites that do this.
Yeah. I mean, it's definitely not confirmed.
Yeah.
Wow. Interesting. All right. What do you have for us now, Josh?
This one is super interesting because I have experienced this unexplained sleep disorder.
That was the longest sentence I've ever heard.
That's because I was building up some
suspense.
Suspense.
Okay.
For you. So this is called the exploding head syndrome.
Oh my God.
I have experienced this in about...
What?
I'm dead serious. You'll see what it is in a minute. I 100% have experienced this unexplained benign sleep disorder. We're not talking about people's heads literally blowing up into a million pieces.
What are you talking about?
So this is interesting. Only 13.5% of people even experience this phenomenon during their lives. It's actually kind of rare. 13.5%, it's not a lot. So imagine, you know, you're lying in bed. You're happily drifting off to sleep. When all of a sudden you're woken up, like jolted, like your whole body shakes, like, oh,
yeah,
because of a loud noise that you hear, but then you find out was only in your head. So some people, the noise that they hear could be something being dropped from a high point, even explosions, hence the name exploding head, exploding head syndrome. So people literally hear like in your head and you're like looking around like something like that happened. And it didn't, obviously. Gunshots are another one.
I see where you're going with this. Okay.
Ringing bells, banging screams.
So you think the time that we were in college and you woke up and started screaming about guns going off.
Yes.
Like Josh literally got out of bed and went to the window and was looking outside. You think that you experienced this?
100%.
You really think you heard it though? Is it possible you were just dreaming about a shooting and then you thought it was happening?
No, because I was in... It happens usually on, you know, before you actually get into a deep sleep. It's as you're falling asleep.
Oh.
So I'm like, and that's what was happening for me was like, I was going to sleep, got to work in the morning and you were still awake. You were, you know, going to bed after me, but I was laying there.
No, I was dead out.
Were you?
No, you're thinking of the time that you saw like a demon in the corner of the room falling from the ceiling. Oh, yeah, I was awake during that.
That's true. Yeah.
This time I was dead asleep and you woke up screaming about gunshots and I almost called 911 because I thought you really heard them and I just didn't because I was sleeping.
And I did. I swear to you, in my head, I heard pop, pop, pop.
Wow.
Jolted. Like I jolted awake as soon as that happened, jumped out of bed and ran to the window. I was looking out the window all frantic, like, and like all confused because you were like, what's going on?
I was freaked out.
But there was nothing. Ooh. So this is an actual real sleep disorder that, funny enough, commonly happens with college students.
Oh, wow. That is Isn't it interesting?
Yeah.
Wow.
So there was a study where they actually did a study about exploding head syndrome with a bunch of college students. And in this study, 49 college students who had all experienced exploding head syndrome were interviewed about their symptoms by either a clinical psychologist or a doctoral student. And although their experiences varied, some had experienced only one episode while one person reported 150 episodes.
Oh,
and it revealed some commonalities among the people that experienced exploding head syndrome. For example, the most common type of noise that people reported hearing was the sound of someone dropping an object from a height, followed by a bang, an explosion, and a door slamming. Those were the most common noises that were heard by the people that experienced this.
So why are they calling it exploding head syndrome? I feel like that's a tad dramatic.
It is a little, because obviously... Maybe
like loud noise in your sleep syndrome.
Well, a lot, yeah. Well, a lot, it's...
Sleep delusion syndrome.
Nah, it's not as interesting as exploding head syndrome. But another 14% of the people in their study forgot how to breathe during an episode of exploding head syndrome.
Forgot how to breathe? Like once they already woke up?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. So like, maybe I wonder if it's connected to sleep apnea?
I was going to say, forgot how to breathe. That sounds like me. Like hold their breath.
Yeah.
So again, this exploding head syndrome is completely benign. There's nothing that's going to kill you from this, but it is going to, you know, scare you. And it scared me. It
scared me
when
too.
It happened to me. And the thing about it is we don't know why this happens. There's no explanation for it. We have scientists think that it's probably a stress-related thing.
I think so.
Which would make sense because I was very stressed out at the time with work and school and everything. So
yeah, and a lot of personal life stuff too.
Yeah, yeah.
You just had a lot going on. I was under
immense stress for a lot of years.
There was a couple years there where you were having night terrors a lot and waking up freaking out, and you never do that anymore.
No.
Ever.
Not at all. No. Yeah, it's very weird.
You're in a much more peaceful place, I feel like, with your life.
Yeah. And I think stress could really be one of the big triggers for it.
Mm. So when's the last time you would say you experienced this?
That night. It was the only one time.
That was
unless
it?
There was a time.
Yeah, probably the only time. Yeah.
Oh, I'm in the bed every night, so I know. I don't think anything.
No,
else
I heard it once, and that's why I do think it is a stress related thing. So I wonder if any of you out there have experienced this exploding head syndrome, because I bet you a lot more people out there would be like, oh yeah, that's happened to me before. I've never known what that was or why it happened. But, you know, I just thought my mind was playing tricks on me. But the key to it is it's you audibly hear it. Mm-hmm. Nobody else does but you. But you're hearing that loud sound in your head, which is again, why it's called exploding head syndrome.
I've never heard of that. That's really interesting.
All right, Kendall, what do you got next for us in this potluck? I'm eating this shit up.
Eat this shit up. I have something called the Dancing Plague of 1518.
Oh, I've heard of this.
Have you heard of this?
Oh, yeah. This is...
I've heard of this. Yeah. Oh,
damn.
This is wild, though.
This is pretty cool if you have not heard of this. Pretty weird. Okay, so this takes place in July of 1518 in the city of Strasbourg, then part of the Holy Roman Empire. And there was a woman named Frau who all of a sudden just stepped out into the middle of the street and started to dance. And people were like, wow, Frau, you're looking good, doing your dance moves. That's great. Like, she was entertaining people and she was just in the street and they were like, wow, Frau's happy. It's all good. But then after a day, she didn't stop. She was going a whole 24 hours and then it turned 48 and then 72. And then after a few days, other people joined in and they were like, we're going to dance with Frau. So then by the end of the week, over 34 people were dancing in the street. Could have even been more. And they were not stopping, like going until they were absolutely exhausted. No breaks, just dancing in the street.
What about going to the bathroom?
I don't know the answer to that. They could have like ran in and gone to the bathroom real fast. I don't know. Or they're just doing it in the streets. I have no idea. But a bunch of people were doing it. And, you know, at first this was lit. Like, it was a big street party. It was fine. People are just dancing. What's the harm in that? But then people could not stop. And before, you know, they knew it, over 400 people joined in to dance in this one location. So it's like a giant, what are those things called?
Oh, yeah.
Flash mobs. Mm-hmm. It's like a big flash mob, but no one could stop. And then people started to die.
Just dropping dead on the ground.
People started to have heart attacks because they weren't stopping, or they just got so exhausted that they would just pass out. People were sleeping on the ground. And it was all outside. And it started to freak out, obviously. It started to freak out the, you know, rulers. They were like, what the fuck are people doing?
What are they smoking then?
And, you know, it felt like they were under a spell. That's what they thought back
then. Okay, so they're like, there's a witch in here that's mm-hmm. bewitching these people right now.
Mm-hmm. And local physicians at the time said that it could be hot blood.
Hot-blooded.
They had a fever and they were just gyrating their fever away.
That's me all the time.
Getting it out. That's really what they said.
That's me every day. Hot-blooded.
You are. It's having a move. Insane, this guy. It's hot all the time.
My ears blow up like...
They really do. Red. Okay. Anyway. And they had no solution to help these people. I mean, they were being like, yo, you should stop, like settle down with the dancing, but they were not stopping. So they decided, you know what? We might as well just like help them dance. Maybe if they dance enough, they'll just get it out. So they built a big stage in the town so that people could just get up there and dance whenever. And they had music going on up there. And it just was a thing that all these people were participating in, over 400 people. And this went on for over a month.
All right. Well, it must have been some lit music, man.
Damn. Right?
Is that where the song Dancing in the Streets came from?
Dancing in the Streets?
What's the song? Dancing.
Oh, yeah.
Dancing in the streets.
Yeah, we dance. Yeah.
I'm sure they were really fucking sick of it, though, at the end.
What you wear. Okay, sorry. But then at one point, they started freaking out and thinking that they're like possessed and all they could do is pray away the evil.
Of course.
So they ended up going up to this mountain, this spiritual mountain that had a shrine up there. And they prayed for them to be able to stop dancing. And they did. Suddenly, everyone just stopped in September. So this went on from July to September. Yeah. And it sounds like maybe just a legend or something, like this is just a story, but it's not. This is well documented in 16th century historical records. And it's not the only time that it's happened. It's happened several times and mostly all over Europe, but also Switzerland, Germany, and Holland. It's documented. Dancing plagues. And so there is a modern possible explanation for this.
Drinking the Kool-Aid. They all drank the Kool-Aid and they danced for days.
No, sadly, that's not it.
Sounds like an old Woodstock. Everyone's just like in the streets.
Yeah,
dancing.
Maybe it was like the first music festival of all time. And they were all hyped up on something and just dancing.
So they think that it's possible that this is just a form of mass hysteria, which there's several examples in history of people you know, becoming mm-hmm. hysterical because of stress. They were worried that they were stressed out at the time about Saint Vitus, which is a Catholic saint that they were worried had the power to curse people, and that they could have been cursed with the dancing plague that could have caused their stress. Then as more people got stressed, the hysteria grew. And I don't buy it though. 400 people.
Yeah, not everybody was stressed too.
I know.
So why is it some people and not others then?
I don't know. I mean, I understand dancing when you're stressed out, but for 3 months.
Nonstop?
Yeah.
All right, let's define dancing for a moment here.
They were like wildly flailing their bodies. Is what
they looked possessed and they looked like the devil had taken hold of them. They're speaking Latin. They're not speaking,
just dancing. And you know, one explanation for it is the same thing that they said possibly could have caused the Salem witch trials, the ergot, which is that rotting wheat that has effects as acid. So basically maybe their bread was making them trip psychedelics essentially, but for 4 months or for 3 months.
Damn. That's some strong shit, man.
I don't know. That's a lot of bread. So
how do we know they didn't just have some psychedelics and they were doing
all 400? And I mean, for that long, if you take psychedelics, don't you crash eventually?
Well, maybe they had their, you know, wheat drink, whatever. And everybody everybody was just drinking, you know, the poison.
What are you talking about?
The poison drink, you know, what you just referenced, that, you know, there was
ergot. It's not a drink. It's bread. It's wheat.
Okay. Maybe
where'd you get drink from?
Maybe they made a drink of ergot. They were serving up some ergot food, and that's they knew they were going to get fucked up by eating it. So
Don't you think word would get out though? Like,
no, because
they're taking all this bread. That's why they're doing it. Yeah.
Then what's the answer? There's no answer.
No one knows. That's why I picked this topic.
Well, it's not fucking hysteria. That's some bullshit. If you ask
I know.
Me,
like, I feel like that too.
Cause
why don't we see that today?
People just like, oh, he's dancing. I'll dance. Yeah. For days? Sure.
For days? For months? Absolutely. I know, it's weird. And the fact that it's happened so many times, that's what's really weird. That's what got me. Because at first I thought this is probably some like made up legend, but it's not.
And none of the rulers took place, you know,
participated? No, they did. They were trying to figure out, no, they didn't participate, but they were trying to figure out why and help them.
And then they magically went to the top of a mountain and prayed to Zeus or something.
And it stopped.
That's why I don't believe it was bread, because I wouldn't stop it.
Yeah, right?
So what if that prayer stopped it, what does that suggest?
I feel like they were cursed or something, or they were under a spell for real.
Really? There was like a dance?
Maybe it was Frau. Maybe she wanted everyone to dance with her. No one was joining in. And she was like, you know what? I'm going to just put a spell on them all and they're going to start dancing with me.
That would be fun.
Could be.
What a nice spell. I would dancing like to know spell. That one. That one's a good one. Interesting. So the dancing plague of
18.
Wow. Janelle, you got something else for us?
My turn? Yes. Okay, this is another weird phenomenon, whatever. This was captured back actually earlier this year in April. April 22nd, back in...
My birthday.
Yes. And Earth Day, odd enough, which is interesting because this has to do with Earth, kind of. And this took place in, oh God, here we go. Balinkalig.
No.
There you go. Balinkalig. I looked it up so many times. Yeah. If it's not Balinkalig, I'm going to be really angry.
Balinkog.
No, Josh.
No, absolutely not. Balinkog. Ireland, by the way. Balinkalig, Ireland, which if any of you are from Ireland, sorry that I said it right. Mispronounced it. I know I looked it up so many times. I'm really trying here. Balinkalig. It's fun to say.
Yeah, it is.
Okay, so you know how, have you heard of like perihelic circles or halo effects in the sky?
Yeah, as a result of the sun. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. There's these things in the sun that can happen where, you know, angles and light, I guess, I'm not no scientist, so I don't know, but they match up correctly and they form this halo around the sun, essentially. But the halos are always, you know, really, really circular. They're always perfect circles. However, this one guy captured a video, and we'll go ahead and play it now. Another
one. That is absolutely crazy. Never seen that in my life.
Okay, so when you're kind of just looking at it off the video, you're kind of like, okay, so what's the big deal? Like, is another one of just those halos? However, this one specifically, especially in this picture, you can really see it. One of the halos has a flat like edge to it. It's kind of more of an oval shape than a perfect circle. And if you look at other perihelic circles, there is nothing that looks like this. And so people were shook as fuck that it was not a total circle and that it was an oval. Yeah. And therefore they thought it was not a halo after all. And because I mean, here's an example of one that it usually looks like. They're very circular. Mm-hmm. This one is clearly...
looks squished.
Squished, exactly. And so people have never been able to figure out exactly what happened or why. They obviously, you know, scientists just say, oh, it was a perihelic circle, but it doesn't make sense why it looks so squishy compared to all the other ones that we've ever really seen on Earth. So a lot of people think that it's some, maybe like a projection of some sort, or it could be aliens.
What about the fact that there's two of them?
Yeah, I guess that's not as uncommon. Like some of them do have multiples, but I agree that like a lot of them, the two of them kind of, I don't know, this one is completely outside of the other, of each other almost. Like they barely overlap, and that's normally not seen. Like see how this one here is like within that.
And then see how the second circle, the larger one, has those two darker spots towards the inside. What the hell's that?
Yeah, I think that might be part of like the reflections. I'm not entirely sure. Okay. Some of them I've seen have that, some of them don't. So I don't know if that's like something special, but yeah, I don't know.
How long have these been seen for? Like, I'm sure they've been seen for a long time. Yeah.
I'm sure they're, and I don't think they're like super uncommon. I've never seen one though. Mm-hmm. Like, and I never had heard of it before looking this up.
Cause I can only imagine what like, you know, 500, you know, or 5,000 years ago, if somebody looked up in the sky and saw something like this, that they would automatically assume, you know, there's a higher purpose to this. Like this is a sign of something, you know, from the sun god or...
And it almost looks like an eye shape with that center. I was going to say that. It kind of looks almost spiritual.
Yeah.
Holy. It just looks like so glowy.
It'd be interesting that the sun would make an eye shape, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, the fact
without
that
the
it's
eye,
squishy,
no light, so
looks weird. It's it's like egg shaped instead of a circle.
Yeah, that's odd.
Which is odd because I believe that. No, again, I could be wrong, but I believe that part of the reason why this forms is because our Earth is circular, and so when we're reflecting off, like naturally, it's going to have a like spheric.
That really can't shape. Be explained.
Yeah,
I don't know. That is odd. Whoa, how'd you find that?
Honestly, I don't even remember. I was just looking up, I think I was really into the natural phenomena this time around, if you couldn't notice in my two stories. So
I like it.
Yeah.
That stuff's always so really interesting. Mysteries of the Earth.
I would love to see one of those in real life. If I didn't know, but like now that I know it's this, I would have for sure been like, what the
aliens 100.
100.
It's always aliens.
Right? It's always aliens.
Well, speaking of aliens, that's what my next topic revolves around, actually. But before I get into that, like to thank our last sponsors for today.
With the holiday season right around the corner, we're getting into the spirit by indulging in the sights and sounds and scents of the season. One thing I made sure to do was update my Native collection with their latest candy cane holiday scent. Native is the perfect addition to your holiday routine this season, and let me tell you why. Native deodorant doesn't just block odor better, they are made better with ingredients that you can actually pronounce and that you've heard of, such as coconut oil, shea butter, and it's vegan and it has never been tested on animals. And Native never uses ingredients that shouldn't be in deodorant, such as aluminum, parabens, sulfate, or talc. And their candy cane gift set also makes a great gift option, so you can hook someone else onto Native this year. Native is a product that I personally truly stand by. I absolutely love their deodorants. It really does work. All you got to do is give your body a few weeks to adjust to a natural deodorant, and then you will be impressed by the power of nature. And it has really improved the condition of my underarms just because they're so moisturizing and made with coconut oil and shea butter. We truly love Native, and now you guys can check it out and give the gift of Native by going to nativedeo.com/milehigher20. Or you can use the promo code milehigher20 at checkout and get 20% off your first order. Make sure your order is in before December 7th to get your products in time for Christmas. That's nativedeo.com/milehigher20 and use promo code milehigher20.
It feels like the holiday season sneaks up on us earlier every year, doesn't it? If you're not already thinking about holiday shopping, you're behind. That's why I want to let you all know about a great place to get everything you need this holiday season. And that place is Zebit. With Zebit, you can shop thousands of products from your favorite brands and pay for them over time. How nice is that? They have everything from Xboxes to TVs to tools, cookware, and furniture, and so much more. And Zebit gives you the option to pay just a portion of that price at checkout, with the rest spread out over time in easy, affordable payments, which is great for this time of year for buying gifts for the family because it allows you to not have to spend all of your savings on Christmas gifts, and instead you can get everything you want while paying it off over time in easy, affordable payments. For example, you can go on there and get a Samsung Smart TV, 55-inch. You know, normally that would cost something around $700-$800, but boom, you can pay $50, $100 and pay it off over time in easy, affordable payments. Zebit even has gift cards from all your favorite places like Sephora, Bath & Body Works, and Foot Locker. So whether you're in a pinch and need a last-minute gift or you want to shop somewhere else, Zebit's gift cards have you covered. With Zebit, there's no cost to join, no hidden fees, and no gotchas. With flexible payment options and an amazing marketplace, Zebit is the best place to start the holiday shopping season. Get a head start on your holiday shopping. Sign up to shop on Zebit today at zebit.com/milehigher. That's ZEBIT.com/milehigher. Zebit.com/milehigher. Check it out today.
All right, Josh, what do you got for us?
All right. Next thing I brought to the potluck is the Black Knight alien satellite. Have you ever heard of this before?
No.
This is a very interesting sort of theory, but this object really does exist. We don't know what it is, but a lot of people refer to it as the Black Knight. And the reason for this is they believe it is an artificial satellite that's just going around in orbit, in retrograde orbit, so the opposite orbit of the Earth. And they believe it has extraterrestrial origin. And it's been orbiting the planet for 13,000 years.
Whoa.
That is just this unknown thing.
And it's going orbiting in Earth?
Orbit?
Yeah. It's
reverse
orbiting.
Orbit?
Yeah. So it's Earth is spinning this way. It's spinning around that way.
Yeah. Going
around.
I know what retrograde means.
Yep.
Is it actually moving that way or does it appear to be moving in retrograde?
No, that's the way it's moving.
Whoa, that's weird.
Mm-hmm. Huh. So again, there's a lot of things that are orbiting the Earth. There's 100,000 plus satellites orbiting Earth right now.
Does this overlap into like a UFO picture that's really famous of like a little black floating thing in the
yes,
sky?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's exactly what it is.
I
want to
see it. It's famous. How have I not seen it?
Pull it up so we can take a look at it. So this object was up there before even Sputnik, which is the very first satellite in orbit. And so NASA, what's interesting is that these are actual pictures from NASA that NASA took.
Wow. This is amazing.
And so NASA says, okay, whatever this thing is not a satellite. It's not extraterrestrial. This is actually a piece of space trash from the 1998 STS-88 mission, space shuttle mission. So the pictures that we have of this Black Knight satellite are pictures taken by this STS-88 mission on their way to the International Space Station. And all these images are in NASA's archives as well. So this is a collection of photographs that were taken when the STS-88 space shuttle was on its way to the ISS, the International Space Station. And these are all official NASA pictures in their archives. There's links to them and everything. And this is the so-called Black Knight satellite.
That's crazy. This thing looks like it has wheels.
Does that look like a piece of space trash to you?
No, so it really does not.
And it changes forms too. And like people are saying, oh, well, it's tumbling and it's opening up. Whoa. And that's, you know, it's just this thermal blanket is what they essentially say it is. That a thermal blanket was lost. And these are just pictures. But why would they take the time to capture these pictures of a space blanket flying?
Yeah.
This thing is clearly changing forms.
Do we know how big it is? Because it looks pretty big.
Yeah, it does look pretty big. We don't know exactly how big it is, but...
what the hell?
I mean, does that look like a... That looks like a alien satellite to me.
Yeah. Wow, that
like,
is,
what is
whoa.
That? Okay.
Yeah, come on.
Okay.
It's like there's fire on it. It looks like it's...
What it,
blasting off.
How do you explain that away? Like the blanket caught fire, maybe?
Maybe it's just the light. What?
Okay.
That's, it could be reflecting, though.
So for comparison, check this video out from the actual mission itself where they did lose a thermal blanket so you can see what that actually looks like and judge. So this is a piece or a thermal blanket that was lost off of the
space shuttle. That's what I was way more expecting.
It's not black, for one. It looks like
a piece of aluminum foil like floating around.
Yeah. And notice that it's not really changing, you know, forms like as dramatically as
the other. I was about to say, excuse me, hold on. Are you singing Katy Perry?
Maybe.
God. No, that does not look the same whatsoever. Are you kidding?
Okay. So based on those pictures, if we think about this and we decide that, okay, this is some type of satellite that's potentially been up there for even thousands of years. And it has, you know, some otherworldly origin. Mm. You know, we always talk about this idea of aliens. And if aliens were here, you know, what would they be doing? Well, one of the things that they would probably be doing is reconnaissance. You know, they'd be surveilling the planet. And perhaps they do have some sort of device or ship like this that is just kind of in our orbit that we don't really, you know, notice or know about until this mission where we captured pictures of it.
Just sends info back.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, because if you think about, you know, some of these, like we were at the beginning of this episode, we were talking about fast radio bursts and things like that over the years. And we talked about this with Nikola Tesla. I mean, he picked up in 1899, he was picking up radio transmissions that were from something alien. We don't know what, but from somewhere else. And perhaps he was picking up transmissions coming from this Black Knight satellite. So that wasn't the first example, though. I mean, over the years, there was another time in 1928 on Oslo, Norway, where they picked up some radio echoes that were coming from outside of Earth, and they were basically rebroadcasting them, and they didn't know what it was. And so they theorized that perhaps this could have been the Black Knight satellite as well, that just over the past 50 to 100 years, we've been, you know, picking up these anomalies, you know, coming from space, and perhaps it's actually originating from this Black Knight satellite.
Is it possible that the radio burst from our first story of the day, of the episode, is from the Black Knight satellite?
No, because we it's way beyond that. Like, they could see how far that traveled.
Yeah.
It was way farther. Sense. This is like right up above us, you know,
in our around atmosphere.
Us. So if it is right up above us,
not then in the atmosphere, but
why don't we go and see it when we're in the space station? Like, why don't we wait for it to come into a...
Well, I think
it's... Why don't we catch it, put a net out and get it?
I think it's gone now. I think it's, like, disappeared.
What?
What?
That's
weird. It's not
weird.
Up there anymore.
Like, shit, they're onto us and they left.
Wait, that's weird.
Yeah, it's not been seen since, I think, 1963, potentially. Like, it was
and around... And they're just good with being like, it was probably a blanket. That's it.
Well, I mean, there's people that have gone on and tried to, like, debunk this whole thing. And a lot of... Like, if you were to look up, you know, NASA's website or something, they would just say this is space debris. Yeah. It's tumbling. There's similar examples where it could be that. So there is a very real possibility. This is just a piece of space junk that is in orbit, like tons of other space junk that's up there.
That's true.
You know,
there's a lot of space junk up there.
So it's possible. But again, I mean, there was astronaut Gordon Cooper in 1963. He was orbiting the Earth and he reported seeing a glowing green light in front of his Mercury 9 module. Seeing weird things up there back in 63. I mean, there wasn't that many satellites up there.
Just the amount of astronauts who report seeing something weird while they were up there is enough for me. I mean, they're not just seeing strange phenomena that has no explanation.
No, I mean, they're clearly seeing something.
Yeah.
And is this Black Knight satellite, in fact, you know, some type of extraterrestrial spaceship or, you know, device to surveil the Earth, or is it, you know, just a piece of junk that we happen to get some pictures of? But again, why would they take the time to take all these really detailed photos if it didn't pique their interest?
Yeah,
clearly. You know, they clearly see a lot of space junk and other shit floating around that they know is, why do we need to capture that, you know? So the fact that this has been, you know, out there for potentially thousands of years, way before man even knew how to put things into space, is kind of interesting. So, but then again, with any, you know, conspiracy like this, you can't really verify this. So believe what you want.
You heard it here first, folks. Believe what you want.
Okay, so my final topic is some more history because that's what I find most interesting.
History mystery?
Yeah. Well, yeah, I guess so. Kind of not really, though. It's just something cool. So in 1971, there were a group of construction workers digging on a hill in, I hope I say this right, but Mwangde, near the Chinese city of Changsha. And they were actually going to be building this raid shelter in the area near a hospital. And this was just a hill. They had no idea that anything important was in it, but they were shocked to find out what was inside. So they ended up coming across a tomb, and that automatically halted, you know, their
excavation,
their project. Yeah. So they brought some experts in, and they found this tomb way beneath many layers of soil and sand. And when they opened up the tomb, they found a bunch of things in it. The excavation process actually lasted nearly a year, and archaeologists had help from at least 1,500 volunteers, which were mostly local high school students. And this was the tomb of Li Cheng, who was the Marquis of Dai, which I'm sure I'm saying that somewhat wrong, but he governed this province until approximately 2,200 years ago. And this was during the rule of the Han Dynasty. So the tomb had as many as 1,000 precious artifacts inside, including golden and silver figurines of musicians, mourners, animals, and they were all intricately crafted. She had a ton of household items in there too, or the family did. As far as like plates, they were really into cooking and eating. So they had, and drinking, just a lot of like 70% of what they found were just plates and cups and things like that, but very fancy items. And all of this is cool, but the real discovery that was amazing was the discovery of a mummy of Qin Sui, which was the wife of Li Cheng. And she's also known as Lady Di, which also Lady, you know, Princess Diana is also known as Lady Di. So different Lady Di, obviously. And this mummy is known nowadays as, like I said, Lady Di, the Diva Mummy, or the Chinese Sleeping Beauty. And she was found wrapped in 20 layers of silk. And her coffins were found like nesting dolls, almost. Four coffins, one inside of each other. Mm-hmm. So it was a very elaborate setup. But what was special about this body that was found was it was in incredible condition. When they first opened her up, it looked like she had just died within a few days. Like, it was insane how good she looked at first. Her skin was still supple and moist, they said. It looked like regular human skin, just slightly, you know, decayed looking, but incredible for how long it had been. The most well-preserved body of all time. Her muscles were in good condition. You could literally bend them and move them. After being sealed in this underground tomb for more than 2 millennia, and they think that she was immersed in some type of liquid. There's like this acidic red looking liquid that was at the bottom of her coffin, which some scientists say that it just dripped into the coffin over time.
Yeah.
But many others think that that liquid was actually made to preserve her, and that's what kept her so nice. But as soon as her body was exposed to oxygen, when they brought her out of her tomb, she started to slowly decay. So there's actually pictures of her. If you'll pull it up, Janelle, it's Lady Dai.
I was going to say the preservation of the body is likely due to the fact she was in this nested coffin.
Oh,
where that was totally sealed.
That is what it is. Yeah.
Wow. That's kind of wild.
It's honestly really scary looking. Yeah, the
skin's all still there.
Isn't that incredible? Wow. And she looked a lot better when they first brought her out. There's no pictures when she was first taken out of the tomb, but it happened quickly. So this tomb was incredibly well designed to keep her, you know, still looking pretty good. She looked very good. Her skin looked, you know, amazing. She even had veins, and they were able to test her blood and see that she was type A. That's how well preserved it was.
That's wild,
man. Isn't that?
I mean, God, they knew something that even the Egyptians didn't know.
I know.
As far as preserving a body like that for
It's so interesting long. That we don't see more bodies like that from this era, though. It clearly wasn't something they did that often. Maybe they didn't realize how well it worked. How would they be able to test it?
Or it's just an anomaly with this woman for some reason. She just was like one of, you know, the chances of this happening were so slim.
No, because as soon as they brought her out, she started decaying like a real body. And, you know, she's decayed now. It's not like she's still like that. But
So it was the way she was
entombed. It was the tombs, yeah. And possibly that mystery liquid, which no one's been able to figure out if that was actually used to preserve her, if it was just leaking in.
Did they ever test that liquid or?
No, they were not able to ever figure out what it was. It's just called an unidentifiable acidic liquid. Hmm. So it could have just dripped in there. But they were able to figure out that she was 50 when she died, and she most likely died of a heart attack. And here's the wildest part about this is she still had melon seeds in her stomach. A lot of them. Her favorite food was musk melon, which I've never even heard of that. But apparently you eat the seeds too, because she had hella seeds in her stomach and none of them were even remotely digested.
Interesting.
Because the body takes an hour to start digesting seeds, I guess. And so she was killed within, or not killed, she died from this heart attack within an hour of eating this melon.
Yeah.
And they don't think she knew that she was going to die or like felt sick or anything.
Weird. So to me, that means she was entombed in this coffin like right off the bat, pretty much, like really quickly.
Like it was almost ready for her.
Yeah.
That was a good point, maybe.
Because like, I mean, even in normal conditions, like you start decomposing within a couple days, you know, like your body starts breaking down. And so, I mean, the pictures of her, she definitely looks like in, you know, pretty good shape for how long it's been.
I know.
So maybe there was some trick that they did. Maybe they specifically were planning to preserve her.
There clearly was a trick of some sort. It's just, what was it? How did they do it?
Because, man, if there was like some secret way to preserve a body, like without having, you know, using cryonics, like that whole thing where you're freezing your body.
Just the fact that no other corpse has come remotely close. I mean, I watched a documentary on this too, some of it, and they showed clips of when they did surgery on her, like, well, not surgery, an autopsy. Yeah. And just they opened up her organs, look like normal organs. They look like obviously discolored and kind of funky looking, but
it doesn't make any sense.
It looks like a body. It's wild.
Any normal person would have decomposed over that amount of time. Like,
yeah. Yep.
So why her?
Because of the way they preserved her.
Why her?
Well, I don't know.
Why
preserve her? She was special. She was loved by her husband.
Are they hoping that we'd like bring her back to life like one day?
I don't know. Maybe. I was thinking about that earlier. Like, what is the point of trying to preserve your body?
And you if know, you're like, spiritual, then your body, your soul leaves your body. So
like clearly don't, I feel like when they do this, they don't want people digging them up years later. And there was a lot of debate in our comment section about just, you know, whether or not we should be digging up tombs of ancient people. And is it just disrespectful as hell? But a lot of people make the argument for science. So there was a lot of, you know, disagreements back and forth in this, but clearly they like wanted her to be preserved and left alone. And maybe they wanted her body to be able to live on forever in a sense. And we kind of fucked that up by taking her out.
Yeah. Where is she now?
I don't know. Actually, I really don't know. I don't know how much is left of her. They may have buried her rest of her remains.
I was going to say, dude, just put her back in the thing and put it back in the tomb.
I doubt they did that. But yeah, they have a bunch of articles that you can go see in the Hunan Provincial.
I wonder if they notified her family too. Be like, hey, we dug up your ancestor here. Look, great condition.
They can like track down who she's related to. That would be cool. Like,
well, I mean, look how much, I mean, they probably take her fingerprints, footprints.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, they can probably,
I mean, not that they'd be able to like run it through a database or something and figure out.
I don't know if they were able to get fingerprints, but DNA and blood samples. Yeah, for sure.
That's what I'm saying. It's like, you probably match up the DNA with living relatives. Could, I'm sure.
That's a lot of work. Anyway,
quite the medical mystery there.
Isn't it?
I like that. Well, this plays well into my last topic here, because mine has to do with ancient history. We love that around here, don't we?
Yes.
So this is very, very interesting to me, because I don't know. What do you think about giants and the idea that perhaps at one point in our history, maybe there's even a whole chapter of human history where there was exceptionally large human beings that walked the planet?
I mean, hey, a lot of people believe in giants. A lot of people believe in fairies. It's possible.
Where are the skeletons?
Yeah, where's the skeletons? Oh, I agree. I feel like I haven't seen enough evidence.
Some stuff. Yeah, they've definitely found some. I mean, we could do a whole episode about giants and stuff. But
there was that big bone, right? That big femur bone?
Yeah, well, they found a heart. They believe they found a giant heart.
Shit.
And it was a fossilized heart that was enormous. It would not fit any animal. It clearly was like a human heart.
Maybe it was enlarged.
Yeah.
No, we're talking like... whose heart's fitting this?
Maybe it was like a T-Rex heart or something.
No, it's a human heart. But anyways,
just being a free thinker, you know.
I like it. So this is called the Giant's Footprint of South Africa. If you want to pull it up, this is very, very cool because in the side of this rock, which I believe is granite, there is what looks to be a left foot of a giant being of some sort, a human foot, five toes. Some people say there's a six on the end, but this is an actual thing in South Africa. And the man that's in this video is actually Michael Tellinger, and he is somebody who studied this for a very long time. It was actually discovered in 1931 by a hunter in the area. So we've known about it for a very long time, but it hasn't really been studied or taken seriously more than just sort of a rock anomaly. You know, like the same way that people see things in the clouds, people are like, oh, this is just some happens chance of, you know, nature that it created a literal footprint in this rock. And what's interesting about it, if you look closely at the top near the toe, especially near what would be the big toe, you can see how there is a portion of dirt that's kind of pushed up out. So if you think about if you were to step in mud, how you would make a footprint and the mud would rise above the foot. So it kind of looks like that's exactly what happened here. Whatever stepped here actually create, you know, at one point, this rock was actually not rock. Mm-hmm. It was ground up. It was soft, and whatever stepped in it, and it pushed up some of that, as you can see at the top there.
Okay, but here's my question. What is stepping in that direction up a side of a rock?
Well, that's the thing, is that over time, this is thousands and thousands of years old, so this terrain has changed a lot. So this was once horizontal, but it's now become vertical with weathering and erosion and everything that it's actually, and it's actually solidified because it was not solid rock to start with. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that does make sense.
And it could have, you know, gone up that way over a long, long period of time, thousands of years.
That is really interesting. However, I will say I'm not completely convinced because I think that that definitely could be a natural shape in the rock. I mean, look at this, look at the rest of the rock. When he kind of pans over, there's areas where it almost looks like dug in as well in the same type of shape. Like they're similar.
Yeah, there's lots of indentation. Mm-hmm. There's lots of indentations on this rock face for sure.
Also, the foot, the toe is coming really out to the right. But I could see how, you know, it could just be misshapen, or maybe the giant had a, you know, kind of bony looking foot. It's a little deformed. Maybe I have seen some people's feet that are kind of questionable like that. So I don't know. Maybe it is a giant.
But I mean, look at the top. You can clearly see what looks like toe imprints. Like,
I know, but what are the chances? Something else?
What are the chances that nature creates a perfect foot?
People see Jesus in toast. Is that real?
Well, I mean, you got a point, and that's what, you know, other people have come and studied this. For example, one professor came out there and with this guy to look at it, and he basically just said, you know, it's basically what you said, the idea that, you know, we see angels, animals, human faces in the clouds, and, you know, this is just a natural simulacrum, is what it's called.
Simulacrum.
Yeah. It's like this natural just occurring, you know, thing where things look like things we recognize, but they're not really.
As fun as it would be to believe in giants, I'm just not convinced enough.
Well, I mean,
I think I've seen enough, and that doesn't convince me.
Okay.
Josh is like, God damn it. Well, that's all I have.
Okay. Not convinced.
It is kind of cool.
So here's some other ideas. So this guy, Michael Tellinger, who's in that video, he believes that at one point in time in our human history, there was giants that walked the earth. There is actually, he's actually found a decent amount of evidence, large bones, the fossilized heart that I mentioned. There's a lot more evidence that's out there. Some even claim to have found full skeletons. There's a lot of bullshit with that too. There's a lot of fake stuff that's out there, but there is some decent evidence for it.
Well, maybe we should do an episode on this.
We should. Absolutely.
believer versus skeptic.
Well, and also, yeah,
it's a series we want to make. What do you think, guys? Let us know.
Give where, us a thumbs where up I if you argue see that. For something and you argue against it.
Yeah,
that could be fun.
It'd be really fun.
But this is pretty interesting. And his theory is that this was giants that were happened to be mining in this area back in ancient times. Mm. They were mining the granite that was there. And that's,
how do we know they stepped that, into though? That.
Well, look, I mean, he's also going off of, you look at, you know, the Bible, Goliath, the giant was, mentioned in the Bible. He was a very, very large human. So that's one example of a giant. I mean, some people debate whether he was an actual giant or he could have just been like Shaquille O'Neal at the time. And he's just like a big tall. But I mean, I forget what the Bible says, how tall he was and how big he was. Mm. But the Bible refers to him as a giant. Mm. So there's this belief that if you look at the Sumerians and you look at their creation story, the Anunnaki and all of that, you know, there is mention of the Nephilim, which were these giants that were roaming the planet, living amongst us for a long time, and they went into hiding or they were killed off.
How can they hide like that while they're giants?
It's a giant planet. There's a lot of places you can hide.
Oh my God.
I'm telling you, there's a lot of possibilities here with this. So,
all right,
where are the other footprints? Like, he was walking. Why is it just one?
Right.
Why wouldn't there be like at least one more somewhere in the vicinity?
Well, because it's been covered up by weathering and erosion, and this one just happened to end up vertical while the rest remained horizontal. It's one idea.
Maybe.
But yeah, you bring up a good point. Why isn't there just footprints of giants all over the place?
Yeah, you'd think we'd see quite a bit of evidence, or there would be more bones and more
giant homes. Skeptics. Like big forts and
Well, thousands and thousands of years ago. This is thousands of years
do you know
ago.
How many things that are thousands of years old that are still hanging out? But
maybe the giants were very primitive and they weren't actually building themselves houses and
they just slept on the ground.
Maybe they did. Or they, as legend goes, they lived in caves and, you know, things like that. So
wouldn't there be more evidence of, you know, civilizations carving That's into what the I'm wall saying. That like, oh, we have giants. Here's a
there
giant.
There is. There's examples of that.
Oh, well, then there's maybe we have to do that episode. Because I feel like Janelle and I need some convincing on that one.
We got two skeptics here. Maybe. I'm the only believer. So maybe there's someone out there that's with me on this, but I think there's a possibility there was giants, and I think perhaps there are sleeping giants still alive today.
Sleeping giants.
Do you think Bigfoot maybe is just a giant?
No, Bigfoot is not a giant. He is his own species. Sorry. If we want to get in that debate, we'll have to say that for another day.
Okay, let's not. This has already been a long episode.
But we'll end it there.
Yeah.
That's all we got time for today.
That is our Ponder Potluck.
But hopefully there's something in there that piqued your interest, or maybe you never heard of something we mentioned today.
Yeah, we definitely want to hear your feedback on the topics that we talked about today.
And what do you think about a skeptic versus believer series? Let us know, because I would love to do that. I'd love to like make an argument for something and then like you guys try to debate and debunk it. Mm-hmm. That'd be fun, actually.
It would be fun.
Because, I'm a Bigfoot believer, so we'll see what you guys
think. And I am, like, the biggest Bigfoot skeptic. Like, I believe in a lot of stuff, but Bigfoot is one thing I'm like,
no.
Me too.
Well, maybe we'll have to do that soon. So. Yeah. But until next time, guys, make sure you like, subscribe, follow us on iTunes, Spotify, all the places, Twitter, Instagram. But we'll go ahead and wrap up today's episode there. Hopefully you enjoyed this episode of the Mile Higher Podcast, something different from the past month. We decided to switch it up today, but we'll be back with some more unsolved mysteries, true crime coming at you very soon. But until next time, stay safe
and stay woke.